So this week is a shorter Shabbat service than we normally do. Normally our services are about an hour long. This service is going to be a half hour long, and then we're going to have a longer service later tonight. So at 7:30 Eastern Daylight Time, that's 7:30 New York time, we're going to have services with Adi. Adi is going to lead a 30-minute Shabbat service followed by an hour of Torah trivia. So if you like trivia, if you like game shows, I highly recommend coming back for that if you feel like you are underwhelmed by the 30-minute Shabbat service. So as I mentioned earlier, my name is Rabbi Patrick Aleph. I'm the executive director of Punk Torah, which is the organization that houses One Shul. However, there are lots of different leaders. Matter of fact, we have a few of our leaders davening with us here tonight. Ketzira is one of our leaders. Rivka is here. I'm looking at the list. Those are the first two I see immediately. So we're going to go with that. And we have people from all over the world. Tonight, we have Michael from Houston. We have Mackerel Mint from Portland, Oregon. We have Alex from Mississippi, Jenny from, let's see, from New Orleans, Lower Ninth Ward. We have Val, who I believe is one of our Darshan Yeshiva students, maybe. I think that name looks familiar. I might be completely wrong. I hope I'm not saying that wrong. We have Tanya, maybe, from Germany. We have Gurion from the UK. Who else do we have here? We have Rivka, of course, like I mentioned earlier, from Louisville. We have all kinds of people. Lots and lots of exciting people. Washington, D.C., Florida, but we'll be in Chicago soon. So we have people from everywhere. That's the great thing about our community. Not only do we have people from all over the world, but we have people from all over the world in terms of Jewish perspectives. Now, this is a short Shabbat service because I wanted to talk about something a little bit different tonight. We're going to have our music and all of the things that we normally do, albeit a little bit abbreviated, but I wanted to do a little experiment or a little discussion. So in the chat room, I'd love it if you would tell me if you have ever used chopsticks before. Chopsticks, as in the sticks that you use to eat Chinese food, Japanese food, probably other cultures. All right, you bet. Yeah, lots of people who've eaten with Chinese, who've eaten with chopsticks. Okay, so my next question would be, how did you feel when you ate with chopsticks the first time? Do you remember that first moment when you used chopsticks? Do you remember what that experience is like? And can you tell me briefly in the chat room what it was like? And I'm going to read some of the answers. Michael says it was awkward. Let's see. Who else has some? Frustrating. Doc says it was frustrating. So awkward, frustrating. What else have we got? We've got a few people who don't remember what it was like. They've been using chopsticks for a long time. But we have at least two answers. One was that it was awkward, frustrating. Another awkward, trying to make sure I was doing it right. Okay, yeah, so that's basically, you know, the answers that we're getting here. The first time you do anything, it's going to be a little tricky. Val says very clumsily. So yeah, so this is kind of what I was expecting, all right? So here's what I think. Chopsticks is a good metaphor for something that I want to discuss, which is what happens when you do something the first time, or when you are new to something, or when you are exploring something, whether it's using chopsticks, perhaps going to a restaurant whose culture you're not used to, the customs you're not used to, maybe visiting a foreign country, or perhaps taking on a new religion, right? These are all, you know, different things that all kind of relate to the same idea. So here's what I think are the three essential issues that you have. Number one is that you don't know what you're doing, right? We heard some of that from the chat room, right? You don't know what you're doing, and that's stressful. But there's some other parts that are even more stressful. The next part is that you know that everyone else knows what they're doing. So here you are with your chopsticks, or here you are trying to ask for directions or whatever the case may be, and everyone else is doing fine, right? Everyone else is doing great. They're getting in and out of that train depot in that foreign country, or they're ordering from that menu in a language that you don't speak, or they're going to that Shabbat service where they're, you know, standing up, sitting down, bowing, not bowing, bowing this way, bowing right, speaking in this language, then speaking in this language, right? Everyone else kind of knows what's going on, right? Okay, so then there's the third part that ties all of this together. Not only do you not know what you're doing, and everyone else knows what they're doing, this is the really awful part. Everyone else knows that you are doing it wrong, that you don't know what you're doing. And that's the thing that's the scariest. That's the thing that makes us sit in the back row of life, is that we don't want to go there. It's uncomfortable. It's unsafe. You don't know what you're doing, but everyone else does, and they can see right through you. Have you ever had that experience before? Have you ever had that experience where you are, let's say, at a Shabbat service or some other religious event, or you go to anything, and it seems like you don't know what you're doing, and everyone else knows what they're doing, right? And there's that awkward, awful tension. So let's see what people have to say. Let's see. Jenny says, this is my whole life. Okay, yeah, there we go. That's honesty. Michael says, yes, it's why I don't go to the morning Torah service. Ooh, isn't that interesting? Choosing to opt out of faith because you're afraid that everyone else knows that you're doing it wrong, right? Crystal, who I haven't talked to in a while. Good to see you, Crystal. I hate not knowing what I'm doing in a new job, school, religion, anything, right? This is a horrible feeling. This is a feeling that just destroys us, right? But it's not just not knowing what you're doing. When we're by ourselves and we don't know what we're doing, like, as an example, when I work on our websites for Punk Torah and One Shul and I'm doing little coding type things, I often don't know what I'm doing. I have a heck of a time trying to figure out. I've got a little book and I'm looking through and trying to find the answer for how to change this color or make this image go here. You know, I'm Googling, trying to find an answer. But that's not intimidating, right? Because if you screw up, it's your own fault. No one else is watching you. But imagine doing that in front of 70 people who are all expert programmers, right? That would be very intimidating. And that's the way we really feel. We don't have a problem with doing things incorrectly. We don't have a problem with not knowing the answer or not knowing the proper procedure or the rules or whatever the case is. It's a social anxiety that we have. And this all relates to, I think, something that's a lot bigger. And I want you to think about, what do you think might be the bigger issue behind all of this? I want you to think about that. You can feel free to post in the chat room. We have a few people who've already kind of started sort of germinating some thoughts on this. But I want you to think about, what might this all have in common, all this anxiety, all this social anxiety? What might be the root of all of this? What's the original, let's call it, ancestor of all of these issues? And while you think about that, I'm going to play Lecha Dodi by the Maccabees. Shama v'zachor v'diburechad Yishmianu kelam yuchad Hashem echad Shema echad, l'shem u'l'siferes v'l'sila, l'cha dodi, l'gras kala, b'nei Shabbos neka. Below, he saw it. Wonderful version of Lecha Dodi by the Maccabees. So we have lots of different answers that people have put in about what they think the root of all of this is. The fear of being unworthy is something Val said. Alex, again, with fear. And fear seems to be the sort of the root that we're coming up with. So I'm going to tell you what I think this is all about. But I'm not going to quite give it to you yet. Instead, I'm going to ask you I'm going to tell you about the three things that I get asked about all the time. So, Punk Torah has been around since 2009. It started off as a blog, and then eventually it grew from there. And it's been my full-time job since about 2010. So, there's three things consistently that I get asked about every single week. Collectively, these three things probably 30 times a week. Easily, 30 times a week if you add all three of these things together. It'd be funny actually to do a little quiz. I'm not going to, you know, give out the read it all, but I'd love to know what you guys think those three things are that I get asked about constantly. 30 times a week when you add them all up, these three things, because it's at least 10 of each every week. What do you think those 30 same requests, comments, suggestions are? And this is Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, mostly email. What do you think those 30 things are that the Punk Torah community gets asked about and that I get messages about all the time? Give it a shot. Tell me what you think. Everyone had an opinion on the other stuff. Okay, so we'll see what you guys think. Okay, so let's see. Conversion. Okay, you nailed it. Michael got the first one, right? So conversion is the first one, and that's absolutely true. At least 10 emails a week about, I want to convert to Judaism on the internet. How do I do it? Can you do it? Can you do it for me? Can you do it for free? So that's question one, or some variation on that, generally. Let's see what everyone else thinks. Let's see, kosher? No. I mean, I do get asked about kosher, but that's not one of the big ones. There's two more. Any guesses? One of them has to do with Darshan Yeshiva. That'll help. That'll give you a little bit of a hint. Does anyone want to guess? Starts with an S or a Shin. What would be something related to Darshan Yeshiva that I would get asked about all the time, at least 10 times a week? Going once, going twice. You win a prize if you guess it. Going once, going twice. Smicha! That's right. Smicha, ordination. So I get asked about ordination all the time. So that's number two. Number three, I'm just going to go on ahead and give to you because it's a bigger one. The email starts off with this. Hi, Rabbi. My name is blank, and I want to know if I can be blank Jewish. Blank Jewish. Now, what does blank Jewish? I literally mean fill in the blank Jewish. Or another variation on it is, I am blank, can I be Jewish? Or can I be blank and Jewish? So what is the blank? The blank is, can I be tattooed in Jewish? Can I be lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender in Jewish? Can I be liberal in Jewish? Can I be conservative in Jewish? Can I be black, brown, Asperger's, autism, blue-collar, rebellious, formerly Christian, polyamorous, socially awkward, mentally ill, and still be Jewish? It's fill in the blank, can I be Jewish? Here's who I am, can I also be Jewish? So those are the three things. Conversion, ordination, do I count as a Jew? You know, my father is Jewish. My mother is a Christian. We were raised Christians. Can I be Jewish? I have a tattoo of Ganesha on my back. Can I be Jewish? Right? There, it's can I? It's asking for something. I am blank, which should be the opposite of Jewish. Can I also be Jewish too? So those are the big three. Now, this relates back to the chopsticks comment that I made earlier. What I think all of this has in common is legitimacy. Legitimacy. And I've been thinking about this a lot for the past 2 weeks. I think that legitimacy, the desire to be legitimate, is the single greatest issue that faces the Jewish community as a whole, but then also faces us as an online community. So I'll tell you a story. When I first started blogging at Punktora, when we were just a YouTube channel, no aspirations of being a big community like we are today, I had actually not finished my conversion. I don't remember how long into blogging as Punktora that I had actually halakhically finished it. But nonetheless, I started off as a non-Jew blogging about Jewish stuff. If you go back to the earliest videos, because that's what we were a YouTube channel, we weren't a website or anything like that. You are looking at a non-Jewish person blogging about Judaism. So when I first started blogging at Punktora, video blogging, I had not finished converting. Now, someone told me, you can't be a Jewish blogger if you haven't formally halakhically converted, because you're not... What's the word I'm looking for? Legitimate. It's illegitimate for you to talk about Jewish issues if you have not gone through the process. So, what happened? Well, I eventually did convert. I finished up. So some time goes by, and I get another comment. You know, you're just a website. You're just a YouTube channel, right? That's all it's ever going to be. You really need to be a nonprofit in order to count. Now, this was when blogging, we had multiple bloggers at that point. We had multiple people making YouTube videos or, you know, putting stuff on the website. So it wasn't just me, right? It was all of us as a community. And there's people here in this room who really were helping out in the beginning, the very early time of Punktora, and have been in the community for 4 years. But the comment was, you're just a website, right? In order to really count, you have to be a nonprofit. Count. In order to count. It's another word for legitimate. So, what happened? Well, eventually we did become a nonprofit. And you, all of you here in the chat room, and all of the people who go on our websites, started funding that nonprofit. And that became my full-time job. Was helping you, being supportive to all of the people in the community, building these websites, creating these videos, and all of this exciting media. That's what we did together in our nonprofit. So many months go by later, and I get hit with another comment. You're just a bunch of people online, right? Yeah, you're a nonprofit, and yeah, you've got your website, but you're just a bunch of people online. You have no true leadership because... you don't have a rabbi. You need a rabbi. You can't be a Jewish organization without a rabbi. You can't talk about religious issues. You can't talk about spiritual issues. You can't talk about Jewish history unless you have a rabbi to teach it. Every Jewish community needs a teacher. A teacher is a rabbi. Therefore, you need a rabbi if you're a community. So, does anyone want to fill in the blank on what that could be? What happened next? Well, I became a rabbi, right? So this is fairly new. Became a rabbi on June 29th of this year. So guess what happens next? I wrote an article a few days ago about why I don't do conversions. And I don't, I'm a convert myself, I mentioned earlier, but I don't do conversions. And there's a whole slew of reasons why. You can read all about them. It's on the Punktora website. No need for me to rehash it. But the biggest issue for me is that I didn't want to charge people money to convert. And that's something I would actually have to do in order to do that. Because it takes time away from the online community, and you have to subsidize. Like, who's going to take care of the websites, and who's going to deal with the accounting and all of the other things that we have to do so that I could do those conversions? We'd have to charge someone. Someone would have to pay. And so I didn't want to get into that business. I didn't want to have to charge money for people to join the community. They can already join it now just by coming to OneShul. By being at OneShul, you are part of the community. And if that's what you want, bingo, no conversion necessary. But then someone emailed me, and I got a lot of email from people about this. But one of them stood out, and it said, it's good that you don't do conversions because people will see those conversions as what? What might people see those conversions as? They might see them as illegitimate, not legitimate. And we come back to that word again. Here's what I know about legitimacy. No one can make you feel that way. Your sense of illegitimacy comes from you. It comes from how you perceive yourself. People may think you're illegitimate, but that's something that they have inside themselves that they're pushing on you and that you're internalizing. And really, haters hate. They just do. Rude, cruel, divisive people are just like that. And the quest for legitimacy, that desire, I just want to be accepted, I just want to be in, I want to be with the in people and the in crowd, and I want everyone to put me on a pedestal because I am right. That deprives you of your time. It deprives you of your energy. It deprives you of yourself. It deprives you of healthy relationships. It deprives you of a relationship with God. Because it's not about God at that point. It's about other people. It's about mortal human beings who are going to give you this acceptance, which, by the way, is totally conditional. This week's Torah portion is Lech Lecha. Abraham is told directly by God to go out and go forth, to leave the culture that he knew, to leave the acceptance, to leave the legitimacy of paganism, to leave the legitimacy of idol worship. It's legitimate. That's what everybody does. And to go somewhere else, to a promised land where we would one day be his children. God directly commanded Avraham, our father, Avraham Avinu, Abraham, our father, to fight legitimacy. And as we read later in the Torah, he took nefeshot, or nefeshim, I don't know what the plural is. He took souls with him. Other souls, other people went with Abraham on this adventure. So you could say to yourself, well, but I'm not Abraham, right? Like, we don't live in Bible times. I need that acceptance. I need that seal of approval. I need to know that I am legitimate at what I do. But I have a few other things I want to say about legitimacy. First of all, what looks legitimate might not be. Idol worship was legitimate religion. It was legitimate that if you were a Baal priest and you cut yourself and you bled on the Mizbeach, you bled on the altar, that certainly Baal would give you greater strength or healing. It was completely legitimate that if you sacrificed your first child, that you would have more children. What looks legitimate is often not legitimate. My second point is that you may have to accept the fact that you are illegitimate. And I'm seeing actually some conversations in the chat room right now about that very issue. You may have to accept the fact that you are not legitimate. In the state of Israel, I am not a Jew, and I'm also not a rabbi. I know I'm a Jew, and I know I'm a rabbi. I got a certificate that says so. It's in a frame I got from IKEA. I know I'm a Jew. I know I'm a rabbi. I'm a rabbi not because I went to rabbinical school so much, although technically they're the ones that ordained me, but it was you guys. You guys were the ones who said, go for it. We want you to lead. We want you to build these websites. We want you to print the ebooks, right? I had no desire to be a rabbi. I did it because pressure from you guys, positive pressure, but pressure nonetheless, right? You ordained me. You decided that I would make a good rabbi. And that's why you're here. That's why all 21 of you right now are here, right? Rabbinical Seminary International gave me a piece of paper. You guys gave me a congregation to belong to. But I am illegitimate. I am your illegitimate goy pretend rabbi to somebody. And I am totally cool with that. All I'm asking you is to be cool with yourself. And finally, I have one last thing to say. And then we're going to say Shema. And then if anyone needs to say Kaddish, we're going to say Kaddish. The only person that can make you feel inferior, the only person that can make you feel illegitimate is yourself. Do not give permission to other people to make you feel like less than what you are. Another way of saying it. If someone else treated you as badly as you treat yourself, you'd want to beat them up, right? So don't beat up yourself. And then the third point, if you say to me, Patrick, this is just a bunch of hokey, self-actualizing, Maslow's hierarchy of needs nonsense. You know, I know for a fact that, in the words of Monty Python, help, help, I am being oppressed. If truly you believe that this is all coming from the outside, that it is not you, you're tough. You're tough as nails on the inside. You know who you are. You are a fully developed person, and you're not the one making yourself feel bad. It's all those other people. Interesting that we never know who those other people are. I've had plenty of encounters with people who said, everyone's against me, or the Jewish community doesn't accept me, and I ask them to name one person, and they can't. It all comes from in here. It's not from out here. It's from in here. They're projecting it out and letting it project back. But let's say, truly you are being oppressed. As my rabbi, if my goyish, fake, in Israel, rabbinical school used to say, what other people think of me is none of my business. It's what Rabbi Gelberman of blessed memory used to tell his students. He used to say, what other people think of me is none of my business. What I think of me, what I think of myself, is my own business. But what other people think of me, that's not my business. You know, here at One Shul, we run a community where if you've never done anything Jewish ever, you can teach class. If you've never done anything Jewish ever, you can lead a prayer service. No one here is stopping you. No one here is telling you you're not Jewish enough. No one here is telling you that you are illegitimate. We don't do that to each other because we care about each other way too much to do that. So when I read from people saying, well, I'm just not qualified. Well, I just don't know what I'm doing. Well, no, everyone's going to know that I'm doing it wrong. I know that it's something else, because it's not us. Peer pressure, peer pressure, peer pressure, you have to volunteer. But no, but seriously, this is a safe space. You are legitimate here. You are as legitimate as you will let yourself be here. So let's take a moment to say the Shema. Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Baruch Shem Kavod Malchuto Le'olam Ve'ed. I'd like to invite mourners and those who are observing a Yahrzeit or in the Shloshim period to please say the name of anyone that needs Kaddish said for them. And I will post a link here in the chat room for anyone who doesn't know how to say Kaddish. So we include in the names that people are putting in the chat room all of those who do not have living relatives to say Kaddish for them. We remember the victims of terrorism, not only in Israel, but all over the world. We also remember the victims of Hashoah, of the Holocaust. And because today is National Coming Out Day, I'd also like to include the names of GLBTQ people throughout history who have been the victims of intolerance. I'd also like to keep in memory those allies who, alongside their LGBT brothers and sisters and others, have passed away due to that intolerance. Standing together can be scary and it can be threatening, and it can also be loving. So we say together, Yit Gadal V'Yit Kadash Me Rabbah V'Alma Divra Kirote V'Yom Lich Malchute V'Chayachon U'V'Yom Echon U'V Chaye Dekol Beit Yisrael Bagala U'Vizman Kari V'Imru Amen Yehe Shme Rabbah Mevorak Le'Olam Me'al Maya Yit Barak V'Yishtabak V'Yit Ba'ar V'Yit Ramam V'Yit Nase V'Yit Adar V'Yit Ale V'Yit Alal Shme Dekudisha Brechu La'ila Min Kol Birkata V'Shirata Tush Bechata V'Nechamata Damiran B'Alma V'Imru Amen Yehe Shlam Rabba Min Shemaya V'Chayim Alinu V'Yakul Yisrael V'Imru Amen Osei Shalom B'Mermav Huya Osei Shalom Alinu V'Yakul Yisrael V'Imru Amen. We are trying very hard to create a community that is beyond questions of legitimacy. We are creating a place where you are legitimate. All of us, Rivka, Alex, Crystal, Mackerel Mint, Kim, Alex, Troy, Jenny, Joe, Carl, Katsira, Val, Gurian, Kim, everybody here. Adi, who's going to be later tonight, you're all legitimate here. But it doesn't happen unless you make it happen. It does not happen unless you make it happen. If you think that there is a person on high who is making all of this possible, who is making your legitimacy happen, you're wrong. You're dead wrong. You make our legitimacy possible. And you do it in two ways. You do it through giving a donation. It's in the top right-hand corner, PayPal. Make a donation. Put your money where your faith is. Support what we do here. Support this community. Support its growth. Help us to find more people who need what we can provide. And secondly, volunteer your time. You are legitimate here. Your writing, your artwork, your anything is legitimate here. Your podcasting, your classes, your chats. You want to just host a chat. It's legitimate here. You are legitimate here. So please get involved. Because if you don't get involved, we can't have community. We can't be with you. And that's what we really need. If you have any questions, if you want to get involved, all you have to do is email me, patrick@punktorah.org. That's patrick@punktorah.org. If you're interested in giving a donation outside of online, some people are uncomfortable with that. you can donate physically, again, send me an email. I will always get back to you. All you have to do is send me an email. Email is, you can ask Rivka and Crystal and Carl and everyone else here in the chat room. Email. That's the way to get in touch with me. So I want to thank you again for coming to One Shoal. Please come back tonight, 7:30 Eastern, for Around the Shabbat Table with Adi, and then at 8 p.m. for Torah Trivia Night. Take care, Shabbat Shalom, and thank you again for coming to One Shoal.